गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन। गुड इवनिंग मैम,
गुड इवनिंग मैम। गुड
एम आई ऑडिबल?
इवनिंग। यस वी आर ऑडिबल।
गुड इवनिंग मैम।
ओके, थैंक यू। सो डिड यू गो थ्रू व्हाट वी डिस्कस्ड इन द लास्ट सेशन? Would anyone tell me where we stopped in the last class? I think we were discussing. Yeah, please continue.
Ma'am, we were discussing Bloomfieldian theories and all, mentalist and all.
We have done with Bloomfield. We have started.
Yes. You said you will be starting with block two today. You had asked us to read it and come.
Chomsky's restructure grammar, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so we'll continue with Chomsky. Yeah, yet to start generativist theory. So let's just have a revision on what we discussed. So could you tell me what he's known for? What Chomsky is known for? What made him different from other American structuralists?
Ma'am, he came up with the LAD concept, language acquisition device. He said
Yes.
that language is inherent in us. We just have to acquire it by living in an environment.
Ah. When you are born itself, you are born with a language acquisition device. So when you grow up, you already have the structure within you. So when you grow up, you simply acquire language.
Yes.
That is what he meant by language acquisition device. Then what do you mean by universal grammar by Chomsky? He said something about, he came up with a concept called universal grammar. Could anyone tell me what is universal grammar? Hello? Hello, I'm not getting any response. So didn't we discuss universal grammar by Chomsky?
Yes, ma'am. Universal grammar means basically the aspect of saying or talking in a language is same. It is just that the words differ. Means the tense exist in English also and Hindi also and in Malayalam also. So basically the words only differ, but the sense of talking is same in every language.
Yeah, exactly. So already we have got a structure of grammar. So what we have to do is, you can imbibe, you can get the structure, you can combine the structure of languages from the native speakers, and thereby you can form a grammar so that you can apply that to each and every grammar. That is what, in a short sense of term, that is what he meant by universal grammar. Okay, then I hope you remember generative linguistics, then his phrase structure grammar. I think it's where we were in the last session. Isn't it so?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, please wait. So already the speaker knows a set of principles that he can apply to all languages. So maybe the parameters vary, but still you can create something, or you can create some rules or elements, thereby you can apply that to all human languages. That is what he meant by universal grammar. And did we start a phrase structure grammar? Did we start phrase structure grammar? Did I tell you the concept of language?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Competence and performance. Did we discuss the concept of competence and performance?
No, sir. No, ma'am. Phrase structure as a determiner, noun phrase, predicate. Preposition phrase.
We have certain rules that determine the structure of phrases.
Okay.
We can generate a lot of sentence from some rules. That is what exactly you meant by phrase structure grammar. You mean by phrase structure grammar. So you will get a structure of a phrase that will consist of one or more constituents in a certain order. So from these phrases, you can generate a lot of sentences. That is what you mean by phrase structure grammar. Didn't I tell you about competence and performance? It can be compared to Lang and Parol.
No, ma'am.
Competence is your unconscious knowledge of language, while performance is the way you put it into practice, your actual use of language. So let me share the PPT with you. Just wait. Is my PPT visible?
Yes, ma'am.
So these are his contributions. Finest state grammar. Then that is about most, that is the most basic kind of grammar, which tells us about speech and so on. Then we have phrase structure grammar, the next level. Phrase structure grammar is what we discussed in the last session, that we didn't start transformational generative grammar. So as I told you, you have certain rules for determining the structure. So from those rules, you can generate a lot of sentences. That is what you mean by phrase structure grammar. Then this is a phrase structure tree. An inverted tree diagram is given here. This is the phrase structure of a noun phrase. This is the structure of a noun phrase. A noun phrase can consist of a determiner plus a noun. Okay, so can also be demonstrative. If it is a that or this, it's a demonstrative. So we call it better determiner or demonstrative. So the boy, it is a noun phrase. Can be noun. It is a noun phrase. So it constitutes a noun phrase. Then similarly, we can have a verb phrase, which can again have a verb plus a prepositional phrase. Can when then again a noun phrase. That also that always see, so in the last session. See, look at the verb phrase here. The first, let's take the first verb phrase. It's a combination of a verb plus a noun phrase, isn't it so? The first
yes,
one,
ma'am.
The boy ran a marathon. In that case, the boy ran a marathon. Look at the second phrase. In this particular, the second verb phrase, we get a verb plus a noun phrase.
Preposition.
Here also, is it a prepositional phrase? A marathon.
To the store.
Go to the store is a proposal. There we have a prepositional phrase, but in the first one, run a marathon, we have another noun phrase. So there the verb phrase is a combination of the verb plus noun phrase. So these are different verb phrases. Like let us see the last one. Take your sister to the library. So in that particular verb phrase, you have a verb plus noun phrase plus a prepositional phrase, right?
Yes.
So verb phrases can have a verb sometimes, can have a noun phrase, sometimes can have a prepositional phrase. So we will write the rule as verb phrase is equal to verb, or it can be a verb plus noun phrase, or it can even be a verb plus noun phrase plus prepositional phrase. That's how you get a verb phrase. Clear? Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am. Pardon.
Basically, the verb phrase will start with the verb.
Of course.
Okay.
Start with the preposition. Okay, but you can't always say that noun phrase starts with a noun. Noun phrase usually the head of the phrase will be what constitutes the major part. So if it's in a noun phrase, it is noun. In a verb phrase, it is verb. But in a preposition, it is always preposition. There we have a difference. Because a preposition is kind of connector. So when in a preposition, we always take preposition as the head. Is it clear? So these are some phrase structure rules. Sentence can be a combination. Sentence is a combination of noun phrase plus verb phrase. Noun phrase can be a determiner plus noun. Then verb phrase, verb plus noun phrase plus prepositional plus adverb, noun or pronoun. That's why I wrote PRO, it's pronoun. Then prepositional phrase is equal to preposition plus another noun phrase. Then we can have an adjectival phrase. Okay, that's how it goes. Now this is the example that is given in the textbook. So S, sentence is equal to noun phrase plus verb phrase. So this is a sentence, noun phrase plus verb phrase. Article, here it is article. So you better write determiner. Can be this, that, the, all command are determiner. So this is an example. Some limitations. Again, there are certain limitations with phrase structure, PS grammar. First thing is that rules are mostly context free. You are not given a context, rather you are given a rule. So that you always don't get a context. The rules explain intrasentence constitutive elements, but not intersentence relationship. It only talks about intrasentence constitutive elements, but not about relations between sentences. So again, sometimes there will be imperative sentences which cannot be explained. An example, ambiguous sentences means imperative sentences cannot be explained with the help of phrase structure grammar. Isn't it so? For example, get sit down. It's an imperative sentence where you don't find a subject. But when you have the rule as sentence is equal to noun phrase plus verb phrase, you are given only verb phrase. You don't find the noun phrase there. So you will get confused. Isn't it so?
Yes, ma'am.
So these kind of problems were addressed in his next theory, that is transformational generative grammar. Before that, we need to see deep and surface structure. I think we have discussed all these things in the last class. Surface structure means the derived representation, while deep structure is the syntactic relationship. The underlying structure is the deep structure. And the structure which is derived from the deep structure is the surface structure. Now, examples are, so you can generate many sentences from a deep structure of a sentence, like negative sentence, question words, then passive voices. All these are derived out of the deep structure. So these are all examples for surface structures. Is it clear? For example, the boy is good, the boy is smart. So the negative sentence, the boy is not smart, is a surface structure that is derived from the deep structure. The boy is smart. I saw him. That's a surface structure. And if I'm generating a sentence like he was seen, again, it's a derived structure from the deep structure. I saw him. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
All these are examples again. The window was broken by Charlie. Charlie, who broke the window? Was the window broken by Charlie? Look at the syntactic forms. All have the same deep or underlying structure. That is, Charlie broke the window. The window was broken by Charlie. Second sentence is not actually correct. Charlie broke the window. Charlie, who broke the window, again, can be a part. Even though it's not a complete sentence, it's a dependent clause. It's a clause. Was the window broken by Charlie? Again, it's a sentence. It's a question word. All these sentences are formed out of the deep structure, Charlie broke the window. So in the second sentence, it's just a clause. No, not the second one, the third one. It's just a clause. Charlie, who broke the window, is here. Then the sentence will be complete. It's just an independent clause which is given there, Charlie, who broke the window. Now, next is the next important contribution by Chomsky is TG grammar or transformational generative grammar. It has got two aspects, as the name suggests, transformational and generative aspect. So let us first see what is transformational method. It's a method of stating how the structures of many languages can be generated or explained as a result of specific transformation. So you have some specific transformation rules. You are applying these rules to the basic structure. Look at the first transformation, passive transformation. So when you transform a sentence from active to passive voice, this is the transformation that you apply. I helped John. So you put the subject first, you put the object first, that is John. Then you write the auxiliary, be verb, was, then V3 form, then by plus me. This is a transformation from an active voice to passive voice. Again, look at the question word, interrogative sentence formed out of the affirmative sentence or declarative sentence, he will come, will he come? Again, that is another transformation. So you are applying specific transformation rules to the basic structure so that you can generate different sentences. The rules will be different because the rules for a passive and active transformation will be different from the rules for changing a sentence into an into its interrogative form. So the rules will be different depending on the type of sentence. If you want to apply the passive transformation rule, you have a different rule. But in the case of a sentence transformation into a question, then you will have a different rule. Is the idea clear? Hello?
Yes, ma'am. Negation also come in transformation?
Negation will also come under transformation, but we have a different rule.
Okay.
So you will be given some rules. Specific transformational rules will be given to you. From that, you can generate sentences. See, the passivization rule. Look at the first one. That is passive formation rule. Noun phrase plus auxiliary plus verb plus noun phrase 2. So this is the normal active sentence. Then when you convert it into passive voice, look at the passivization rule. Noun phrase 2 plus auxiliary. Auxiliary is
helping verb.
Is a helping verb. Was or is. Their old be verb is a helping verb. Then do, does, did, they're all helping verbs. So in the first sentence, I saw John. Look at the sentence, I saw John. Then the auxiliary there is did, right? Did plus see is so. Noun phrase plus auxiliary plus verb plus noun phrase 2. An example is I saw John. I is the noun phrase 1. It's a pronoun. Then we have auxiliary. Auxiliary here is did plus verb is see. Then the noun phrase 2 is John. I saw John. That is a normal active. That is a normal pattern of an active sentence. Then look at the passive form of it. The rule here given is noun phrase 2. Okay, so the noun phrase 2 is John. Then auxiliary again is there. That is tense. Tense will act as the auxiliary. Then be verb as an additional one. So that is a that has to be introduced when you convert a active voice into its passive form. So the rule, of course, since it is in passive voice. So since the sentence is in past tense, so we use was, John was, then en form of the verb, that is the v3 form. John was. Auxiliary here that stands for the tense. Auxiliary is past tense. Then be form is the corresponding past form of the be verb is was. John was. Then en plus v means v3 form. That is seen. Then an additional one is there, that is by, noun phrase 1, me. Did you understand the rule?
Ma'am, please explain once again.
See, the normal structure of an active voice is, active sentence in an active voice is noun phrase 1. Here it is the John. It can be a pronoun or it can be a noun phrase. The boy, so, the girl. It's a sentence. The sentence is in past. It is a past tense. It is a sentence in past tense. The boy saw John. This is the sentence. Then let us divide it into different phrase structures. First one is noun phrase 1. Here the noun phrase 1 is the boy, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Then if you look at the verb, you can see that so is a combination of auxiliary did plus verb see. Isn't it so? Did plus see is so. Because when
yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Past form of see.
Did the boy see the girl? That is the question. The boy didn't see the girl. The boy didn't see the girl. So from all these sentences, from yes, all ma'am. These surface structures, we understood that there is the auxiliary did at work. So the boy plus did, that is the auxiliary there. Then verb is see plus noun phrase 2, the girl. This is the active voice form. Then when you convert it into passive voice, you get the rule. The rule is given here. That is noun phrase 2. Here the noun phrase 2 is the girl. Then auxiliary plus B plus EN. Auxiliary means you had an auxiliary in the form of did that showed the tense. So did and do, they're used to show tense. Here also we have the auxiliary. So auxiliary form then plus B. So here auxiliary stands for the tense. tense is past tense. So be form, past form of be is. Be verbs are
been,
are, was, were. These
are was.
Then past form plus be verb is was. The girl was. Again, en plus v stands for the third. En stands for v3, the past participle form of verb. The past participle form of so is seen. Girl
seen.
Was seen. Again, we have the by, preposition by the boy. The girl was seen by the boy. Is clear okay, now? Ma'am.
So yes,
this,
ma'am.
This please. Is how you apply the passivization rule to an active sentence. So we have the passivization rule here. So you simply apply that to an active sentence, you will get the passive form. So these kind of transformations are called a singularly transformation, because you are applying this transformation to single sentence, simple sentences. When you are combining more sentences, you have double-based rules. Double-based rules means you're combining two sentences. So these kind of negatives, for example, negative, when you're converting a sentence into negative, then question, interrogative form, all these come under singularly transformation. Then we have double-based transformation. That means you're applying those transformation to combinations of or clauses. Okay, so they are called a generalized or double-based transformation. You can create complex sentences out of simple ones. Then again, that is using embedding. So through using embedding, you can convert complex sentences from simple sentences. Don't think that Bill will leave. Don't think and Bill will leave. Again, it's a, you are combining two sentences. These kind of transformations are referred as generalized transformation or double-based. You're combining, when more than one clause is involved, you apply double-based rules or generalized transformation rules. Okay, for simple sentences, you apply singularly transformation rules, and for sentences involved for structures involving more than one sentences, you apply double-based transformation rules. Okay.
And what kind of questions can come in exam about these things from these
generative
topics?
Grammar, generative, transformational and generative grammar. So you have to give examples. These are the main rules that he lay under these rules, singularly and double-based transformation rules. Chomsky's generative grammar, that can be a question. Okay. So then we have two types of ordering, which were discussed by Chomsky, that is extrinsic ordering and intrinsic ordering. In extrinsic ordering, you will get the order in which the rules must be applied. And intrinsic order, you will get the sentence which is a result of the rules being applied. These are the two types of ordering. So one is extrinsic ordering and the second is intrinsic ordering. In extrinsic ordering, you are given the rules and you will be told how to apply these rules. And the second kind of ordering, you'll get a sentence whereby all the rules would be already applied. Okay, so there is one thing called a reflexivization or U deletion. So the first sentence is, you hang. See, when you are applying, when you have the subject coming as the object, you apply reflexivization rules, right? Isn't it so? When you have the subject coming as the object, when the subject and object are same, you apply reflexivization rule. Thereby, you delete the you. Instead, you use the reflexive pronoun yourself. Did you understand what are reflexive pronouns? The action is reflected back to the subject. I saw myself in the mirror. You can't say I saw me. So instead, you would use a reflexive pronoun. I saw myself. So that's a reflexivization rule. See, let us check the second rule, second sentence. You hang yourself. That's a result of an intrinsic ordering. You get the intrinsic order. That is, you hang yourself. The order was, you have to delete the you, and instead you have to apply the reflexive pronoun yourself. That is the extrinsic ordering. So when you get the sentence, you hang yourself, that is a result of extrinsic ordering. And now the sentence is in intrinsic ordering. That is, after you apply the rules. That is, you hang yourself. That sentence follow the intrinsic order. But the rules, reflexivization and you deletion, are part of extrinsic ordering.
In ma'am, intrinsic ordering, we have to apply the rules, or the rules are already applied?
It's already applied. The rules are already applied.
Okay.
So here the ordering is a result of the rules. That's why when you see the sentence, you hang yourself, it is given into the intrinsic order, because you have already applied the rule, reflexivization and your deletion. Those were part of extrinsic ordering. Okay. Then we have two types of transformation, obligatory transformation and optional transformation. Obligatory transformations are mandatory, while optional transformations are optional. You don't need to convert it. But in case of obligatory transformation, the rules must be followed, because when you have a simple present, when you have the sentence in simple present, you have to use third person singular with the plural form of the verb. She sees him. That's an obligatory rule. I don't know him. He doesn't know him. These things are obligatory. While when you want to add negative, it's an optional rule. You don't need to do it. Otherwise, the sentence is correct. Auxiliary transformation and do transformations are obligatory, while passive conversion, negatives, imperatives, they're all optional rules. Is it clear? So these kind of sentences, the basic sentence structures are called kernel sentences, because you have got the sentences after applying the obligatory rules. So those sentences are called kernel sentences. While those sentences like negatives, passives and imperatives are called derived sentences, because you have applied the optional transformation rules. Okay, clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Is clear to everyone? So we have optional transformational rule and obligatory transformational rule. Obligatories are do transformation and be verbs transformation, auxiliary transformation. Auxiliary means be verbs have had, do, does, did all come under auxiliary transformation. While passives, negatives and imperatives are non-mandatory, they're optional. Such kind of sentences are called derived sentences. I think it's clear now. Moving on. So these are the transformational rules, prescriptive and normative rules. They are normal and normal orders, like avoid sentence ending with prepositions. Then difference between owing to and due to, where to use I or me. They are normative rules, prescriptive rules. We don't follow these rules in communicative speech, though. Of other traditional rules derived from other classical languages. See, these are all traditional rules. Don't ever end a sentence with preposition, the difference between owing to and due to. Nowadays, we use both interchangeably, owing to and due to. There is not much difference between owing to and due to. Normally, owing to, we have to begin a sentence using owing to, but due to can come in the beginning or the end of a sentence. Due to shows the cause, while owing to means because. So these are some traditional rules. So they are called the prescriptive or normative rules. Then we have descriptive rules. That means based on the observation and inductive rules, what happens to a language. Because that there we have the optional and obligatory rules. Then rewrites rules. So again, we have some symbols given, like noun phrase, verb phrase. So these sentences equal to noun phrase and verb phrase, they are called the rewrite rules. So these are the transformational rules, prescriptive rules, descriptive rules, and rewrite rules. Then we have interrogative rules, how to convert an imperative sentence into interrogative sentence. Then we have affix switching rules. Again, we are moving the affix, is he going, thereby we have moved the affix. Then do support rules, where to use do or does, negation rules, how to make a negative sentence out of a positive sentence. You have passivization rules. All these come under transformational grammar. Then generative grammar also, you are given a finite set of rules. So when you apply these rules, you will be able to generate sentences, which are the grammar, which constitute the grammar of a given language. Okay, now moving on. Let us start discussing the last unit in block one. It is language and thought. It's a very easy chapter. So it discusses two approaches to language. One is the cognitive view and second is the communicative view. In cognitive view, we'll see that language gives importance to the role of language in our thought. It says that it is language which makes our thought possible. Thought process possible. Without language, we won't be able to think. But in communicative language, a communicative view of language, we'll see that thoughts occur independently. It doesn't need the support of language. It can occur independently. That is what you mean by communicative view of language. So we have cognitive view of language and communicative view of language. Cognitive view of language is the role of language in our thought process. It says that language is inevitable to thought. But in communicative view of language, you will see that language or thought is independent of language. Thought and ideas exist independent of language. Now, let us take the first one, that is a cognitive view of language. Earlier, we have seen the importance of language to human beings. It's an important characteristic of human communication. We have seen the concept of signifier and signified. Again, that is what we see in this linguistic sign. So we have seen the connection between the signifier and signified is arbitrary. There is no natural connection between the signifier and signified. But still, when you hear the word apple, you will think only of apple, because that is how the fruit is named. Even though there is no natural connection between the signifier and signified, still, when we hear the word apple, you will think only of that particular fruit apple, the fruit which is named apple. That shows the importance of sign. Even though it is arbitrary, we relate things through language. So we have already seen Sapir as part of American structuralist. Then Sapir, along with his disciple Wolf, came up with a hypothesis which has two aspects, linguistic relativity and linguistic determinism. So in linguistic relativity, language is defined as giving names to each and every thing that we see. Or rather, we can say that there is no natural or absolute way of labeling around the world, labeling the things around us, except through language. So if you are given only one word for water, that is water, you will, whenever you see anything that is related to water, like river, sea, then rain, you will call it as water. But when you have different names to address each of these aspects or each of these things which are related to water, you will remember it only through these terms. Suppose when you see rain, you can call it rain, not water, because you have a different name for that. When you see sea, then you will call it a sea, just because you have a name for that. Ocean, we have river, we have brook, we have fountain. So we have different names to call different bodies of water. So that is because of linguistic relativity. That tell us how different people see world in a different way, because they have separate names. If you're restricted only with one name, you will see that part only through that name. So that is how you enjoy the world. That's how you perceive the world. It is related to language. The way we perceive the world is through language. Is the idea clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So all the things and the names that we use to address them have only arbitrary connection. Even though the connection is arbitrary, there is no other way to label them. Then now let us see what is linguistic determinism. Again, exactly the same thing that we discussed in the beginning of this chapter. language provides the framework for our thought, and it is impossible for us to think outside of this frame. We are at the mercy of our language. That is what Sapir felt. We can't label the things around us except through language. That shows how dependent we are on language. We can't be free from language. We can't think outside the framework of language. In linguistic relativity, we saw how we perceive things in different ways. That is through this arbitrary connection. In linguistic determinism, we see how dependent we are on language. We see and hear and otherwise experience very large as we do because the language habits of the community predispose certain choices of interpretation. We are already given some interpretation and we think through that. We think within the limitations of those interpretations. We can only think in terms of those interpretations. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Next comes the second hypothesis, or the second idea, communicative aspect of language. That by they say that those who endorse this idea say that language is independent of thought. Another critical linguist thinker thinks that thought is the same thing as language. It's an example of what may be called, it's a conventional absurdity to say that we are dependent on language or thought is dependent on language. Language is not at all inevitable to thinking. That is what Pinker thinks. Let us see the example. Case of translation. Again, that's an example. Because that shows that language is independent of our thought. Because if thought independent of language is not possible, no translation will ever be possible. Again, when you read a poem, you interpret it in different ways. You would be interpreting the poem quite a different way from what the author might have thought about it. So all these things show that language is independent of thought. That's why American structuralists completely ignore the idea of meaning. Because when you are given a word, people think it in different ways. Because when I say rose, you would be thinking of the flower, I would be thinking of something else. I can repeat that same word in different ways. So that shows language is independent of thought. You can't say that this is how you think. So that is exactly the example of translation shows. Because again, those people who translate the work interpret the idea of the author in their own context. Again, another example is about polyglots, people who use different languages, people who are experts adapting different languages, who acquire two or three languages as their native languages. Even that shows that language is independent of thought. They use language, different languages at the same time. Again, another example is poem. When you read lines or when you read poem, you interpret it in different ways. Because all depending, so the interpretation of language is dependent on your thought process, not vice versa. Am I right? You interpret the language of that particular poem in your own way. That shows that language is independent of thought. The poet has given you a language, but you interpret it in a different way. Depending on your thought, or depending on your ideas, depending on your cultural context. But we can say that both are almost, you can't ignore both the theories. Both are important, cognitive approach and communicative approach. Can't completely endorse a particular concept here. In one way, cognitive view is right. Another way, when you think about this communicative aspect, that's also right. So that's all about block one. I hope block one is clear to you. Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Shall we start the second block?
Yes, ma'am.
So the block is titled A History of Language. We're going to explore the history of English language. So we have two types of history, external history and internal history. So external history of language studies the changes that happened in a language as a result of its contact with external factors. In external history, so the changes in sound system or the language are seen as consequence of contact with some other language or languages. Then you'll be focusing on the external events, factors, and its contact with other languages there. In case of internal history, language is treated as an autonomous system. So it studies the changes in the structure and stock of languages without referring to the external factors. So language is treated as an autonomous system without any external connections. But in case of external history, we will connect it with other languages also. So when you study English, you will connect the language with other languages like French, German, and so on to understand the nature of change. But in internal history, you will only focus on the evolution of English as from old English to modern English. You won't connect it with external factors at all. You'll be focusing only on the structure and stock of the language. Clear? So moving on. Some of the notable sources that help you with the history of language. One is the Ecclesiastical History of English People, written by Venerable Bede. I hope you have heard of it. And Parker Chronicle, which tells us about the battle where King Cynewulf was slain. Then we have a Table Alphabetical by Rod Corddry. Then another important work is a Dictionary of the English Language, which is one of the most influential work. He took 7 years to complete it, a Dictionary of English Language, Dr. Johnson. The New English Dictionary on Historical Principles. Again, it was something which appeared from 1884 to 1928. This is called then Critical Pronouncing Dictionary. Then last one, English Pronouncing Dictionary. That is what is very, very helpful in improving your pronunciation. English Pronouncing Dictionary by Daniel Johnson.
Where are you reading from, ma'am? Which page number is this?
You can't see it?
Yes, ma'am. Is this given in the textbook?
Yeah, it is given in the textbook. I'm reading it from History of English Language, Block 2. I'm not sure.
It's on page number 6 right now. It's on page number 6 of Block 2.
Thank you.
Now, documenters and contributors of English language, also Shakespeare, Dryden, Wordsworth, I think it's told there in your textbook. Then now we will look at the language family of Indo-European branch. Let us start analyzing Indo-European language family. It gave rise to 10 branches, the most important of which is Germanic, which gave rise to English. Germanic has west, north, and east divisions. From there, from the West Germanic, we had Low and High
page
German.
Number 6.
It is from Low Germanic that English originated. And
Block 2, page number 6.
It is there in your textbook, into this language family. Page number 6, I don't have the textbook. Okay, so Indo-Iranian also is important because Sanskrit originated from Indo-Iranian family. Now, Indo-European languages. It includes 150 languages. Then, again, this hypothesis was proposed by William Jones. Again, very important. It is he who noticed similarities between the oldest languages, like Latin, Greek, Sanskrit, and Persian. Then he compared it with other old languages. And then he was supported by Franz Boek. Now we'll come to Indo-European languages. It was also many people earlier called it Indo-Germanic languages. Scholars used to call it Indo-Germanic languages instead of Indo-European languages. But later the connection of this Indo-Germanic language to other languages became apparent, the name was expanded to Indo-European. So it came after some discoveries made, like the similarity was found between Sanskrit and Alden spoken dialect of Lithuanian. So these are the Indo-European languages, Indo-Iranian languages, Italic languages, Germanic languages, Celtic, and so on. There are 10 branches mainly. Again, even though there are other language families, the most important language family is Indo-European. What are the reasons? First reason is its acceptability. Because these are the languages which come under this family is very important. They are spoken by people all over the world, like English, Spanish, French, German, and Russian. Almost half of the world's population speak one or more of these languages, either as their mother tongue or as a business language. That is why this Indo-European language family is more important than other language families. Again, we have some languages which are important in its multinational context, like Portuguese, Hindi, German, and Bengali. Again, this language family constitutes some classic languages like Latin, Greek, Persian, Sanskrit, and Pali. I don't think these notes are there in a textbook. I have taken it from many other sources. Anyway, these languages are scattered around the world as speakers are part of diasporas like Greek, Yiddish, Polish, Armenian, Romani, Kurdish, Italian, Hindi, Punjabi, Gujarati, and so on. Again, another important feature is it is in inflected languages because they have different word endings. We have already discussed about inflectional languages or inflectional morphology and derivational morphology. That tells us about the word endings. But in case of English, it has lost many of its inflection. But in case of other languages, it has got, like Sanskrit, if you consider a classic language like Sanskrit, you can see that the words have got many inflections. The same noun will have different inflections depending on the position it comes. Again, it is thought to have originated in the forest north of Black Sea. Then people began to migrate between 3500 BC and 2500 BC, spreading west to Europe, Mediterranean, north to Scandinavia, and east to India. Again, Indo-European family is divided into 12 branches, 10 of which contain the existing language. Even though we have 12 branches, only 10 still has existing languages. Then it is also called, the ancestral branch is called the Proto-Indo-European. Even though there are some disagreements to the geographic location, the language families are all originated from the Proto-Indian European, even though the geographic location is still contested. Then we will be thinking of the non-Indo-European languages or language groups. Some of them are Semitic languages, Hamitic languages, Dravidian languages. They all come under different language families. They don't constitute the Indo-European language family, like Dravidian languages, Tamil, Telugu, Kannada, Malayalam. They are not part of Indo-European language family. Indo-Chinese, Polynesian languages, American Indian languages. American Indian means the language of Red Indians. Ural-Altaic language, they all constitute different language families. They don't come under Indo-European language families. Then next important question is, why languages often change into different dialects, varieties, and other languages? Why we have different languages, why we have different dialects for the same language? Like if you take the example of Hindi, you can see that there are different dialects are there. What are the reasons? One is the natural change, because depending on the changes that come across the language or society, languages change, then contact with other language. When the language comes into contact with other languages, of course it changes, then because of the geographical divisions. So there will be structural factors, historical change, and split and family. Split that happens in the family, they all contribute to the changes into different dialects. Indo-European language families, or languages that come under Indo-European language family share some common features. One important feature is they're all inflectional in structure. Even though that is not apparent in modern English, French, and Spanish, they were all inflectional in structure because they used to inflect for phase, number, and person. For tense, moods, and for verbs, when they all indicate, changes in terms of inflection. Did you understand the idea? Inflection and structure. In order to show, tense, in order to show the case, in order to show the, in order to show the aspect, they used to have different inflections. Is the idea clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Because a single word can take different word endings depending upon the position it comes. For example, if it is a noun, if it comes as the subject, it will have a different form. If it is an object, it will have a different form. The inflection will happen on the noun. But in the case of English, we don't find this inflection that much, except in the case of pronouns. In case of proper nouns and common nouns, we don't see this inflection except for the possessive case. Isn't it
prefixes
so?
Prefixes and suffix also comes under the rule of inflection.
No. Not prefixes. Only suffixes. Inflections mean suffixes. Or grammatical changes. It is the word endings that were changed. See, in case of English, we don't find such inflections nowadays because it inflect only to show the possessive case. This is Ram's house. But in case of proper noun, common noun, when they come as subject or object, they do not change the forms. But in case of Malayalam or Sanskrit, you can see the change depending on the position it comes. I don't know how it comes in Hindi, but in case of Malayalam, the word endings keep on changing depending on the position it comes. If it is subject, it has a different form. If it is object, it has a different form. That's how it goes. But in case of pronouns, English also show this kind of inflections because I will be changed to me. They are grammatical changes. Okay.
Ma'am, please give one example of inflection.
Inflection. In Sanskrit, we have different versions for Rama. Ramaha, Rama, Rama, and depending on the position it comes. Okay. If it comes with an adjective, it will become Ramaha. If it comes as the object, it will become Raman. Ramaha, Ramau, Raman. That's how it goes. In Malayalam also, Raman, Ramande, Ramanude. There are different variations for the same noun.
Okay, ma'am.
In English, it is not clear. It is not that apparent. Except in case of possessive. Except when it comes as the possessive noun. In case of a possessive noun, we will see that you use apostrophe plus S. Apostrophe and S. In all other cases, the proper nouns and common nouns remain unchanged. That's what you mean by inflection in structure. That's why it is said that in modern English, only pronouns change. Pronouns show this inflections. And you can also see some internal change within the vowel. Man, men, then foot, feet, all these are internal changes. They also come under inflectional change. Okay. Is the idea clear?
Yes.
Again,
yes, ma'am.
Word, if you take a word like brother, you can see that it resembles the same category, same word in other languages. Dutch in brother, in Dutch is broader, in Sanskrit is this brada, in Greek it is praetor. So all these examples show that they all come from a common family. They all share a connection. They all originated from the same root. Similarly, Prada, brother. Then Pida, Pater, Latin name is Pater. See, somehow the other, you can see the connection. Rudra, red. Then Hamsa, goose. All these show that Dwara, door. All these show that they all originated from a common root. So they have many words common. They all share some common words. Okay. Then again, the oldest literary texts preserved in any Indo-European language are the Sanskrit Vedas. In Germanic, the most ancient records are biblical translations. Then the major difference, we have seen the common features of Indo-European language family. Now we will see the major difference between Indo-European language family and its branch Indo-Germanic. How is it different from, how is the branch Indo-Germanic different from its root Indo-European language family? Now, first point is, I've told you this, Indo-European languages had a very elaborate inflection system for both nouns and verbs. But in case of Indo-Germanic family, they have almost all the words lose their inflection. They have lost their inflection, you can say. Again, Indo-European was an inflection, since it was an inflected language, its word order was free. So you can put them in any word order. Only thing is that the change has to be denoted using the inflection. Change will be already denoted using the inflection. So no matter where you put the word, only thing is that it has to be noted using the inflection. That's why even in Malayalam also, the word order is very free. You can put the words in any order, no matter where it comes. The only thing is that that inflection has to be used. For example, Ramande. Idana Ramande Vida. Vida Idana Ramande. Ramande Idana Vida. This is same. So the word order is free. In Sanskrit, that's Odanam Devadatta Prakati. Prakati Odanam Devadatta. Devadatta is Devadatta just because it is the subject. Prakati Odanam is, give you rice odanam because it is the object, but if it comes to the position of subject, it would be different. If Devadatta is the object, again Devadattana, there will be change like Devadattana. I don't know whether exactly it is Devadattana. I've just given you an example, Devadattana. Maybe it will take another inflection, but still this is how it comes, because Devadatta is the object. So now you can put Devadatta anywhere. Only thing is that you have to use the correct inflection. Since they all come with inflection, the word order is always free in case of Indo-European languages. But in Indo-Germanic, that is a bit different. Is this idea clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, moving on. So again, I have taken Germanic as a branch. So Germanic, we have West Germanic, North Germanic, and East Germanic. Then you will see that English originated from West Germanic, Anglo-Frisian, Netherlandic German. Then you have English and Frisian originated from Anglo-Frisian. Again, it's for your reference. Now, features of Indo-Germanic. I've told you Indo-Germanic is different from other Indo-European languages. These are the features that distinguish Indo-Germanic language from the Indo-European language family. First is, verb inflection became simplified. That means many distinctions of tense and aspect were closed. We have only two tenses now, two tense forms like past and present, and aspect also we have only two. That is present participle and past participle. All other distinctions were closed. Again, declensions of adjectives became weak. Earlier, there were two types of adjectives, strong adjectives and weak adjectives. Now, these variations exist no more. These variations do not exist now because modern English has lost all such declensions of the adjective. Even adjectives used to have different forms. Different adjectives had different variations depending on the position it comes. Because sometimes when an adjective is preceded by an article, it will have a different form. When it comes without an article or a demonstrative, it will have a different form. Okay.
Ma'am.
You didn't understand?
Weak adjective and a strong adjective.
Weak adjective is an adjective which is preceded by an article.
Example, ma'am?
See, for example, this good man.
Okay, good okay. Man.
If it is preceded by an article, if it is preceded by an article, it takes this godan. Godan. I don't know how exactly this thing will come, but it's an example that will come later. So good and man. Now, if it comes along, it is good man. Otherwise, it is okay. Good and man. So that shows the difference of an adjective.
Okay, ma.
Clear. Again, in Indo-European, any syllable of a word could be stressed. But that is why I told you it was syllable stress. Now, when it comes to Indo-Germanic, it is not syllable timed rhythm, it is stress timed rhythm. That means only particular syllable is stressed, not every syllable is stressed. For Germanic, only the first syllable is stressed, but in English, it is dependent on many factors, but only one syllable is stressed in a word. Not even every word is stressed. Only words belonging to the content words category are stressed. But in case of other languages, in case of other Indo-European languages, every syllable can be stressed. Any syllable can be stressed, but in case of Germanic or English, not every syllable is stressed, only particular syllable is stressed. In case of Germanic, it is the first syllable which is always stressed. But in case of English, there are certain rules that determine which syllable is to be stressed. So stress is not free here. But in Indo-European language family, stress is free. You can give stress to any syllable. Is the idea clear? Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Next is in Indo-European vowels change to Germanic vowels. Like Indo-European O became Germanic A. Long R became long O. This I will tell you later because we will be discussing the great vowel shift. There we will see this. Again, Indo-European stops. B, the, G became first B, the and g. That is voice, b, the, g, voiced stops, not aspirated. B, the, g are aspirated voiced stops. Then it becomes first voiced stops, b, the, g, or voiced plosives. So for example, brada became brother, dwara became bread, then hamsa became goose. Pa is an aspirated plosive, then it changed to b in Indo-European. Then dha again is an aspirated sound that became the in Indo-Germanic. Again, gha, an aspirated plosive, became g, the voiced plosive. The first three are aspirated voiced plosives, then it became voiced plosives. Then pa-ta-ka, the voiceless plosives became fa, ta, ha, fricatives. P, T, and H. B, D, G later became, first this aspirated voiced stops became B, D, G, then that B, D, G. That means the voiced stops became voiceless stops, P, T, K, or voiceless plosives. You have seen the plosives, right? P, B, T, D, K, G. These are the plosives. Do you remember them?
Yes, ma'am.
Then they changed to voiceless plosives. These voiceless plosives became fricatives, fa, ta, and ha. Okay, that's why coda became heart.
Ma'am, example for voiceless sound change into fricatives. P to f.
Further, that's why P to became father.
Okay.
I don't remember any every example. Then Peter became father. Similarly, codis, ka, became heart. Codis, ka. Even though the spelling is C, it is ka sound. Codis became heart. Similarly, again, codis, we can take the same example. Codis, heart. That the changes to t. Codis, the became t. So two changes happened there. K became H, then D became T. So these changes are described as the Grimm's law. The changes.
Ma'am, explain second point, declension of adjective once again.
Declension of adjective. See, earlier these adjectives had two divisions, strong adjectives and weak adjectives. Okay.
Yes.
So that depends on the preceding elements. If it has got a preceding element, like if it is preceded by a definite an article or a demonstrative, it is strong. Sorry, it is weak. If it stands alone, it is strong.
Okay.
That's why I gave you the example of goat man. Goat man. Pass, I'm taking an example from your textbook. Pass, God and man. Pass, God and man. It is a weak adjective, God and. It's weak because it is preceded by the article pass, the good man. The good okay. man. There the adjective is weak. That's why it has a declension an. But if it is God a man, it is a strong adjective because it is not preceded by any article. God a man. It is not preceded by any article or any demonstrative. It stands alone. So it's a strong adjective. So gode is the strong adjective form, while godan is the weak adjective form. When adjectives had two variations, that is what you mean by declension. They had two variations, strong adjectives and weak adjectives. Is idea clear now?
Yes, ma'am.
So these are important. What are the features of Indo-Germanic? What all features make it different from Indo-European family? First one is inflectional system, simplify. Then a declension of adjectives is not there anymore. Again, it is stress timed, or we give stress to only one syllable. Again, you should write about the changes that the consonants underwent. It is called Grimm's law. Also, the vowel change and vowel. There are two type of vowel change, umlaut and umlaut. That we will study. Create vowel shift and umlaut. We will study it later. Then second is Grimm's law. Grimm's law tells you how the voiced stops, aspirated voiced stops first became voiced stops. Then how these voiced stops became voiceless stops, and how these voiceless stops later became fricatives. This is what you mean by Grimm's law. Okay, clear? Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Now you will see the vowel changes. Be there, vowel change. So these things you can see from you can read, because you don't have any examples. Indo-European E became either E or A. All these tell us about the changes that the vowels in Indo-European underwent when it came to Indo-Germanic. That's why we still maintain some E letter in the end of a sentence. Sometimes food became feet. They all part of these vowel changes. Okay, but old English German words, we are not familiar with these kind of words, that we won't get examples that easily. The vowel changes, you may read it. Then Grimm's law. I've already told you about Grimm's law. Indo-European voiceless stops change to corresponding voiceless parents or fricatives. You can look at the examples. Pedis became food, pada. In Sanskrit, it is pada. Latin, it is tertius. Canis, we have examples. Latin canis became English, pound. German hunt, English. Latin cord became English what? All these are examples. Indo-European voiced stops, burdug became voiceless stops, pertuk. Sanskrit dasham became 10. Dasham is 10 because der changed to ter. Again, brada became brother. Sanskrit madhu became mead. Hamsa again became goose. Common features of Indo-Germanic languages. These are the features I've told you about it already. A simpler verb conjugation. We have only two for the classification for verbs. One is a strong verbs and other as weak verbs. Weak verbs means those verbs which take inflections is in the form of de or ed. Irregular verbs and regular verbs. We call it regular verbs are weak verbs. But irregular verbs are strong verbs. regular verbs means verb which form their past tense and past participle by taking D or ED. This is called weak verbs in Indo-Germanic, weak verbs. Those verbs which take D or ED. In strong verbs, usually change their internal structure. Sing became sang. Sing has got the past form, sang, and past participle form, sung. That is a strong verb, but in English, we call it irregular verbs. They are irregularly formed verb forms. Clear? So we have also two order classification like regular verbs and irregular verbs. But earlier, they used to have a classification like strong verbs and weak verbs. Weak verbs are those verbs which took inflections, like D or ED. Strong verbs are those verbs which changed their internal structure. Okay? Then again, they had a classification of adjectives as strong and weak. This is example, past, God, and man. Then they had a fixed stress accent. Again, it's a matter of stress. We focus only on a particular syllable in case of a polysyllabic word. But in case of Indo-European languages, they can stress any syllable. Then regular shifting of the Indo-European stop consonants from voice stops to voice to stops. Grimm law. Now the history of English language. We will have the evolution stage, like Old English to Middle English, Middle English to Early Modern English, then Modern English. That's how it goes. So mainly we have three periods: Old English, Middle English, and Modern English. First key dates of Old English, 450 to 150. That period is known as Old English. Then we have 115 to 1500 is known as the Middle English. Then 1500 to 1700 is Early Modern English. Again, 1700 to 1900 is Modern English. 1900 to present is Late Modern English. So we can call the time period from 1500 to present as Modern English. So the languages that have influenced English, 5% Greek, 7.5% Latin. Look at the percentage of Anglo-Saxon, it is 40%. Then 15% knows, 30% French, and 2.5% other languages. Then let's first discuss Old English. Again, you know, England was earlier occupied by Angles and Saxons. They were first invaded by the Romans, which brought Latin words. Then later, they were invaded by Germanic tribes. It is they who established Anglo-Saxon heptarchy in the form of seven kingdoms, South, East, and Central Great Britain. I think you can go through all these things. I don't need to explain it. They converted to Christianity in the late 6th century. That is how the text became, that is why we have the Old English text as in the form of religious text, because it is during that time that they got converted to Christianity. So those books were religious in its nature. Then later they were invaded by Vikings. Their language, that is what we saw in the case of Norse. Norse also influenced the English language. Their language was Norse. The language of Norse. The language of Vikings was Norse. That also influenced the Anglo-Saxon language. So these are the words that we have taken from Old English. They are used even today. I, you, he, she, it. These are all Old English words. And there are some archaic words like fulsome, rich, plentiful, onupan. All these are archaic words. Fulsome, rich, plentiful, onupan, above. All these words we don't use anymore. They're archaic words. But these words are taken from Old English vocabulary. Now, key features. They didn't have an agreed system of spelling. Again, they had a heavy use. They used inflections very heavily. Then they had a musical quality because the words were short and forceful. We had gender in case of nouns and adjectives. Now we don't have that kind of gender divisions in case of nouns and adjectives, but they used to have the division of gender in nouns and adjectives. Even the elements of nature was labeled with different gender. Earth was female, while a sky was male. That's how they classified the elements of nature. Writing system involved runes as well as the Roman alphabet. Then use of kennings. Kennings means kind of compound words, but with metaphorical meanings. So they use the endings. For example, bone house, body. Bone house was a compound word which denoted body. It's a metaphorical extension of a compound word. That is what you mean by kinnings. Flexible word order due to inflection. These were the key features of Old English. Then these were the key dates. 450, beginning of Old English period. 1000, the man of Beowulf. That was the only surviving manuscript. It's an epic which tells us the defeat of which tells us about the defeat by the great king Beowulf. 1066 is the year of Norman conquest. It's a very important date. 1150, we have Middle English period beginning from 1150. Look at the Old English text. This is taken from an Anglo-Saxon chronicle by Alfred the Great. So you have given the Old English text as well as its translation. You will see the difference. You won't find it as English at all. It's completely different language. Now we will come to Middle English. This followed the Norman invasion. From Norman invasion onwards, we call it Middle English, because after Norman invasion, they brought a lot of French words into English language, because the language of the ruler was French. So the language of the court was also French, but the language of religion was Latin. So English was the language of the common man. But as a result of Black Death, there was a need for working class labor. So people started speaking English, which led to the rise in English. Before that, French was the language of court. French was the language of the higher order, while Latin was the language of church. So English was spoken by the laity, common man. Again, with the coming of printing press by William Caxton in 1476, almost 20,000 books were printed. That also improved the literacy rate of England. Then there was an interest in literature due to the accessibility of these texts, which were published in Caxton's printing press. Society was again very religious. So there were many diseases which were disturbing these people because of the lack of medical knowledge. And these are the key features of Middle English. Inconsistent spelling, that was a feature of Old English also. Again, the syntax and imagery was full of that were completely related to Bible, because the texts were mostly religious in nature, and the texts had a didactic purpose. The main purpose of literature was to teach people, to teach religion. So they all had this biblical syntax and imagery. The grammatical conversion, these were the grammatical conversion that were prevalent there: verbification, prefixation, suffixation, compounding. Then there was an influence of, you can see the influence of Bible everywhere in the field of literature, and even in the speech also. The positional semantic shift, lack of do constructions. So they didn't use do or does to make questions. So these kind of yes or no questions were not that common using do or auxiliaries. Rather, they use, look at the word, don't, instead of don't enter, they use enter not, sit not, instead of don't sit. The negative and question words using do or does were not there in Middle English. Even though they use capital for proper nouns, they also they use capitals also for common nouns. Nowadays, we don't use capital letters for common nouns, but they used capitals for common nouns also. Then vowel sound, it is during this time that the great vowel shift began. Then there were many French words, loss of many inflection, word order became more important. Key text, the most important key text of Middle English period is another than Chaucer's Canterbury Tales. It is written in 1387. In which dialect he wrote Canterbury Tales? Could anyone tell me? In which dialect Chaucer wrote Canterbury Tales?
In Petrarchian.
Petrarchian? In which dialect? Petrarchan is not a dialect. Petrarchan is actually the name of a sonnet variation. Petrarch was an Italian poet.
West Midland?
Very good. East Midland dialect. Later, it became the standard dialect of England. Chaucer wrote in East Midland dialect. So some other important texts were Gawain and the Green Knight. Then there were also some religious texts too. Key dates, Henry II. It was during this time that Oxford University was founded, 1157. It was in the year 1157. 1209 is the year in which Cambridge was founded. Then 1476, William Caston Printing Press. 1500, Henry cut the links between Rome and the Church of England. It was in 1500 that he established the Anglican Church. Then some examples of texts. A knight there was, and that a worthy man. See, you remember these lines?
Canterbury Tales.
And this is about the knight, the gentle knight. The knight there was, and that a worthy man, that through the time that he first began. Look at the spelling of began and wrote. This is what I meant by the changes in vowels. Began. He became a to ride an out, he loved chivalry. Then the changes that happened to that EIE combination that changed to Y, truth and honor. So this is an example for Middle English, medieval English rather than early modern English. Again, printing press brought about standardization in spelling. Then it was a time of science and discoveries. Again, religion was still very important. Exploration and colonization also affected the use of language. Again, it was a time of Renaissance and Reformation that led the people to grow an interest in classical culture. Even then, Latin was still spoken and one of the most important classical languages. That also helped the coming of Renaissance because it was the Latin texts that were first read by the people all over the world. I hope you remember Renaissance. Do you know the concept of Renaissance?
Reformation.
Renaissance. Reformation was a religious movement. Renaissance, even though we combined
rebirth of ideas.
The revival of ideas. Rebirth of knowledge. Because with the fall of Constantinople, scholars fled to different parts of the world. And so that literary texts became available to the people all over the European countries. So, as a result, knowledge was accessible to many. It led to the Renaissance.
Okay, ma'am.
So that boosted the literature. Then words of Latin origin. I told you Latin language was still prominent. So these were words taken from Latin. Ambiguous colossal, nation immense, intellect magnificent. We use these words abundantly, but these words have a Latin origin. Then one of the most important figures of early modern English was, of course, Shakespeare. He had a great influence on English language. He made a great impact on English language. He influenced the people. Then he also, his books also show the influence of French and France and Italy, because he also read many French and Italian literature. That is evident from his book, evident from his works. Again, he reduced inflection, he created new words, he introduced idiomatic expressions. Then he also used hyphenated compounds. Hyphenated means hyphen. We are using a compound words with a hyphen in between. This is hyphenated compounds. This is again very important, King James version of Bible. So it is he who appointed university scholars to develop a single translation for Bible so that can be used across the country. So this is a very important biblical version, King James Bible. The year was 1611. It follows an archaic style. Archaic style means an older style. Example is given here. Give dig instead of duck, gat instead of goat. So he maintains some old terms, that is what we mean by archaic style, thou, thy, then, the, so thou, thy, thine, all these are archaic words. I have just given you some examples. Key features of early modern English. Again, it was a time of standardization. Standardization has already started in the medieval, in the Middle English period, but English language became more standardized, we can say. Shakespeare used unusual words, he used some inflections, he avoided some inflection, he introduced new words, he introduced compound words, he introduced idiomatic expressions, Anyway, the inflections, the use of inflections was reduced. And again, phonology was influenced by great vowel shift. Again, this great vowel shift and great consonant shift, both are very important. Then Latin and French influence, again, still remained. Many prefixes and suffixes were introduced. They were, most of them were taken from Latin. Word order became more fixed. That is subject. Now we have a specific word order as subject, verb, object that became more fixed. Then due to Renaissance, literature flourished. Shakespeare's books and Bibles, Book of Common Prayer, that all increased the normality of idioms. Idioms became very common among the people. Then different tense usage also was introduced. Glad we got acquainted. Key dates. Great vowel shift date is 1415, between 1650, 1509, Henry VIII reigned the throne. The Tyndale Bible, Tyndale's Coverdale's Bible, Tyndale's Bible, King James version of Bible. These were different versions of Bible. It was published in 1534. Then 1549, first version of Book of Common Prayer. 1558, Elizabeth reigned the throne. It was with the her ascending to the throne that Elizabethan age starts. Again, it's a very important time in the history of English language and literature. 1564 to 1666 was the time of Shakespeare. In 1611, King James Bible was published. Then again, 1721, Samuel Johnson. It is the he published his dictionary. Again, you have an example of a modern text, early modern text. This extract is taken from Tempest. See, look at the archaic terms that he used. So, context, modern English, Industrial Revolution, the influence of Industrial Revolution, then more technical, again, expansion of England, Industrial Revolution, mechanization, modernization, all those contributed towards the standardization of English further. Then it became an international language, new varieties like American English, Indian English, Canadian English, Austrian English began to form. I told you about the expansion of British Empire, became a superpower, and also the superpower status of US. When they had English as their official language, even still have English as their official language, that also contributed towards the emergence of English as a global language. Then cultural issues were there, like women's children's rights movements were there. Women's suffragette movements were taking place. Religion still continued to play an important role. Key features, spelling became more consistent and standardized. This standardization starts from Middle English and still it continues. Then we have more of American spellings and pronunciation. Newly coined words were used more heavily and quickly. Auxiliary verbs, again, became very common in interrogative sentences. Then possessive pronouns were still in use. Archaic terms like thou and thy are still in use. Johnson's dictionary, he published his dictionary in 1755, not the first dictionary, but it was the most authoritative dictionary. And key dates. Johnson's dictionary was published. Industrial Revolution, 1800. British Empire's expansion of British Empire. Then Webster's book on grammar was published in 1828. Late modern. I think you can go through it. Do I need to explain these things? Hello?
Yes, ma'am. If you share this PPT, then it's okay.
I'll definitely share the PPT.
Okay, then we will read it.
These things are not there in textbook. Okay, I've taken it from somewhere.
Okay, ma'am, where do you share this?
I'll share it in the official group. Won't you
ma'am, is it some WhatsApp group or something?
There's a WhatsApp group by Regional Center. I usually share my PPT there.
Yes. Ma'am, not all of us are from the RC Coaching Center. Can we still get the PPT somehow?
So, are you part of any group in WhatsApp? There are different groups of the students as well. So they usually share the WhatsApp, this PPTs and notes.
if possible, somebody could write it on the chat box, then it would be very helpful for us. The group's link.
So you don't have any connection with any student from RC?
No connection with the RC.
I don't think you'll be able to join the group because it's already full. Oh, you text me personally, I'll send you the ticket.
Ma'am, I don't have your number.
I'll write my number.
Otherwise, ma'am, otherwise I can share a WhatsApp group link of another group where you can share it. I mean, there are many students from that group.
They have, different groups. I think one of you can share the PPT to these students who are from other parts. Other centers or parts of the... See, how came you got the link of the class then?
It's a group on Telegram. We get the link from there. My RC.
You share the PPT in that group.
Actually, maybe I might not get the PPT. I just wanted to ask if I can get it from some group already if it's there.
Ma'am, actually, the Telegram people are already sharing this PPT in that group.
You can get it from there.
Okay, ma'am, and please share your number after the presentation.
I'll share my number. Okay, so by late modernism, English became very standardized. Now we have a standard spelling and grammar system. Acronyms became very common. Acronyms, we have already seen part of word formation. Grammar rules can be flouted more easily. Even now, there are experiments with syntax and conjunctions going on. Slang and jargons are heavily used. Then informal language became very common. We have different jargons. Then key dates, World War I, BBC, the year in which BBC was founded, all the important years are given here. The major influence on modern language development, media, technology, communication, traveling, migration, texting, jargon, slang, education, worldwide language, all these influence the development of English. Now, these concepts are taken into context, synthetic language and analytic language. So, synthetic language means the structural relation within a sentence are expressed using inflection. That means the tense, person, gender, number, mode, voice, etc. will be expressed using inflections. That is a synthetic language. Sanskrit is a synthetic language. I told you, for subject, we have when a noun comes as a subject, we have a form. Then when it moves to the object position, we'll have a different form. So we will add an inflection so that an inflection will tell you this is in object position. So an inflection can help you to understand the position of a noun or a verb. Or a person, tense, gender, everything will be expressed using inflection. That is what you mean by a synthetic language. Almost all Indian languages are synthetic because their word order is not that strict. Word order is free there. Rather, changes will be denoted using inflections. That's synthetic language. But in analytic language, word order is strict. We have a very strict word order. For example, in English, we follow subject, verb, object pattern. That is the word order which is being followed in English. It's an analytic language. So we don't depend on inflection, rather we depend on the word order in case of an analytic language. That is during the modern period that English is completely settled as an analytic language. Earlier it was a synthetic language. So it had many inflections. When English words were inflected for tense, mood, and gender, but now we have lost all such inflections. It became an analytic language. It is settled as an analytic language. Did you understand the difference between synthetic language and analytic language?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Then changes in sounds and spelling. Again, this area, it's not there in your textbook. It's not that mentioned in the textbook. I've taken this from sources. So there are external courses and internal courses, internal reasons. Like external courses can be a desire for novelty, euphemisms, changes in the linguistic habits of the people. See, these are all based on the, syntagmatic changes. Internal linguistic factors means internal pressures, contradictions, excess need for uniformity and standardization. That also lead to the changes in sound and spelling. So these are the processes through which language change: assimilation, rejection, invention, adaptation, derivation. We have seen these processes already, especially derivation, adaptation, modification. Sometimes we modify a noun into a verb. So this is another word is conversion. You can invent a new word. Sometimes you reject an older word. Sometimes you replace an older word with some new one. Okay, these are all processes through which language changes. Okay. See, these are the changes in Old English sounds. First is consonants. These are consonant. These are Old English consonants. So the bracket, the words given, no, don't just ignore the words given in the bracket. It is some other language. I've taken it from a source. So labial sound, we have velar sounds, we have dental sounds. Again, you already know these sounds. These are the divisions, consonants. There was this absence of affricates. We have now affricates. But earlier in Old English, there was no affricates and sibilants. Sibilants means sounds. There were no affricates or sibilants. Then again, they depended on the quality of the consonants on the environment. Sometimes if it's a double consonant, they used to stress both the consonants. So sometimes that consonant will be, the vowel will be prolonged if it is a double consonant that follows it. Old English depended on the quality of the consonants on the environment. Then phonemes denoted by the letters, see, could be voiced or voiceless. There wasn't this strict classification as voiced sound and voiceless. Sometimes the same sounds can be voiced or voiceless. Sometimes in certain position they were voiced, and in some other position it can be voiceless. Then look at the words there. These are Old English words, you may not understand it, but doubled consonants were always voiceless. So if it's a doubled consonant, it's always voiceless. Even though when it stands alone, it can be a voiced consonant, but when it is doubled, it is always voiceless. Do you know what is a voiceless sound? I hope you remember what is voiceless sound.
Ma'am, three.
Sorry?
TH sound.
Without the vibration of vocal cords?
It depends on the vibration of vocal sound. The vocal cords vibrate, they are called voiceless sounds. Voiceless sounds, if they do not vibrate, they are voiceless sounds. See, I've told you earlier that these sounds, sometimes these the letters, the phonemes that is denoted by those letters, F, B, the, they can be voiced or voiceless. But if it is doubled, of course, they are always voiceless. And other times, they are voiced. If we use the doubled consonants, they are always voiceless. So they can come in both the position, voiced positions and voiceless position. That are these sounds, the phonemes denoted by those letters, F, the, S. The second letter stands for the sound, the. For the, sir. Okay? So many changes are given. The letter J was pronounced in three ways, as a velar plosive, as in swords, rectum, and janjan. Then we have R sound, when it comes after back vowels and consonants, then that means the letter J has three pronunciations. Then double consonants were read as long. I told you earlier. So Setian, double consonants were read as long. Now we completely ignore double consonants. We don't have doubling of consonant in English. But earlier in Old English, double consonants were pronounced as long. So these are all the Old English words. That's why you might find it difficult. There's phonetic changes in Old English consonants, qualitative changes, voicing of fricatives, palatization, assimilation. The voicing means these sounds were subjected to a process of voicing and devoicing. I've told you, sometimes they can be voiced, sometimes they can be voiceless, depending on the position of the consonants. Palatization means, do you know what are palatal sounds? Palatal sounds, do you remember palatal sounds? The tongue will be moved to?
Hard palate.
Very good. So the velar consonants only they are velar. When they come before a front vowel, they become palatalized. Again, assimilation. Again, it's a very important process.
Ma'am, could you please unmute down down?
Someone has unmuted them. Please mute your mic. Okay. Assimilation again is a hear what I see. It's disturbing. Please unmute your mic. Sorry, please mute your mic. Hello. Okay. Assimilation is a process of combining two words. Sometimes they I can hear what I say. Please.
Madam, don't. On chedirikkanu. Don't.
Who on it? Who switched on? Hello. Hello.
Ma'am, you can mute the participants.
Let me check. I don't think I can do it. No, it's okay. Is it okay now?
Yes, ma'am.
I think you can go through these notes. Quantitative changes in Old English consonants include loss of consonant, syncopation, simplification. These are some methods. Syncopation means shortening of word through loss of sound in the middle of the word. Frenon. See, Frisnan became Frenon. It's a shortening of a word through the loss of a sound, because in that word, that Z sound is lost, or R sound is lost. Frenon, ask. Sehan, Sehan, Seon. Finally, it became C. The syncopation, simplification means it's a shortening at the front of a word, shortening in the beginning of a word. H is lost in H. Ring. That's why we have ring from the word ring. So they have lost the word has lost it, lost the H sound, which came in the beginning. Then metastasis again. It's you can see that two sounds will be exchanging their places. Look at the word breeda, maybe per or ber. That's an Old English sound. Look at the way it changes. Then r and e sound, the vowel and consonant changes its position. So this is called a metathesis. Then gemination again is a doubling of consonants. So this is called imute. This is followed by imutation. Takes place only if the preceding sound is short, before ear and e sound. Hello.
Yes, ma'am. You are audible.
Changes in English sounds, vowels. These are the Old English monophthongs and. You can also see the Old English diphthongs. Again, there was Old English short vowels and long vowels were almost same, except for A. Then again, the diphthong in the second element was more open than the first. You can see that the first two diphthongs starts with E sound, that is A sound, but they are more open. They are in more open position than when it comes in the second position. You can see that it's an open position. Open means open. I hope you remember the tongue position the vowels take. Open, half open, close, half close. Can you recall it?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So the diphthong in the second element was more open than when it comes in the first position. These are the changes. These are the changes, quantitative changes and qualitative changes. Fracture. So these are some of the methods through which vowels changed. Fracture, palatalization. Already we have seen the palatalization in the case of consonants. Mutation. I mutation. There are three types of mutation. I mutation, back mutation, and mutation before the sound her. It is because of this mutation that we don't usually pronounce the X sound in words like night, right. It is because of the H mutation. Then quantitative changes in Old English vowels. Earlier we discussed the qualitative changes. Now it is quantitative changes that is used, that is represented through lengthening. Look at the first word. Sild become child. It's lengthened because that vowel became a diphthong, child. Bindan became bind. Climban became, climban became climb. That is because of the consonant cluster. The vowels will be lengthened when they are preceded by a cluster. So the short vowels became diphthongs. Lengthening. Some consonants were lost as a result of this lengthening. Sade became said. Masden became maiden. These are all examples for lengthening. Now comes an important shift, that is a great vowel shift. So when you look at these words, you can see that vowels will be raised to the position of the next level, to the next position. When it can't be raised any further, it became diphthongs. Usually vowels can't, when you use your tongue, it can't touch the roof of the mouth, then it becomes consonant. So it will be raised to the maximum level. Then when it reaches the level from where it can't move any further, it became diphthongs. This is called a great vowel shift. So look at the spelling. In Chaucer's pronunciation, it is leaf. In Shakespeare, it is leaf. Modern pronunciation is life. Chaucer's spelling was leaf. Then it became leaf. See, then A became A, A became E. E can't be raised any further. So it changed to a diphthong I. Can you see that? If, that is why leaf become life. Because that long vowel E, leaf became leaf first, then it became life. That is because of the great vowel shift. Similarly, naam, a sound became name due to this great vowel shift. Again, a was a closed vowel. It was a open vowel, then it became a half closed vowel, then it became a closed vowel, then it changed to a diphthong. Then naam became name. So these are all examples of great vowel shift. Is this idea clear? The vowel will be, each vowel will be moved to the next vowel. The vowel that comes in the position above it, then when it reaches a position from where it can't move any further, it becomes a diphthong. That is what you mean by great vowel shift. Okay. Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Next is changes in sounds and spelling. I've told you it is only by the modern age that spelling became standardized. Earlier it wasn't fixed, but it did not change when the long vowels changed. Even though the long vowels changed, the consonants didn't change much. So the English earlier, the English spelling became largely unphonetic. Okay, so when the changes started much earlier, especially regarding vowels, it wasn't complete. It is only in the modern age it became complete. So some examples are given here. You have the textbook with you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Okay, for example, in case of Anglo-Saxons, Old English had only two. Old English had the sounds the and the. But Latin did not have those two sounds, the and the. Instead, they have a different sound, like the and. You can see that. Latin did not have that the and the sound. So yeah, they didn't have the characteristic to spell them. So they had a different, like you can see that a new symbol, the. Instead of, in front of that, the, they have a different, they had a different symbol. That they used to represent both the and the. Because when Latin influenced English, they didn't have different symbols to represent these two sounds, the and the. Now we have the and the sounds. Because we have this and thin. TH combination can stand for both the sound and the sound. But that Latin did not have different forms to represent this the and the sound. So they used both symbols, both sounds interchangeably. Okay. Is the idea clear? So the and the were used interchangeably. They didn't have different symbols. That's why even now we have the same TH combination to represent both the sound and the sounds. Because in orthography, they didn't have different symbols to represent both these variations. So they used both the sound, they represented both the sounds using the same orthographic symbol. Is it clear?
Okay, ma'am.
Next is letter S. Again, letter S had two distinct pronunciation. First as in T and as in CH. K and K is there, then CH is there. Okay, so as in came, as in church. So they had two different pronunciation for the letter S. They used to pronounce it as K and also as CH. So came and choose. So that shows another influence of Latin. Again, the French influence. When you talk about French influence, they had different, the letters Y and Q were used interchangeably. For example, K was given like new phonetic values were attached to. So K and Q sound, Y and Q sounds were given wide use. So both letters were used interchangeably. Similarly, S sound was given due to French influence. S sound was C. The letter C was given different pronunciation as in S, then CH, then also as in K. Am I clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So French, due to French influence again, V sound. V and F sound were used interchangeably. For example, wolf. Wolf, when you use the pronoun, it became wolves. So, they pronounce V as F. That's why Volkswagen or Volkswagen. Because they have the different pronunciation for both V and F. Okay, that also shows the French influence. Is clear?
Clear, ma'am.
Due to the influence of French, again, F was often pronounced as V. Because F, the voiced form of F is V. That still it is maintained. That's why when you have the plural sound, wolf becomes wolves. The spelling, even though the spelling changes, pronunciation remained the same. Similarly, there was this E-O combination, E and O combination, but they later became monophthongs. Even though it was a combination, it was kind of diphthong combination, it is now used as it's a vowel. That's why we have some combination like D-E. Even though earlier it was D-E-O-L, E-O combination. Actually, it's a diphthong, E-O. E and O sound, A-O or E-O. It's a combination, it's a diphthong. But still we pronounce it as E sound, it's a vowel. So many diphthong combination, even though they retain the spelling, but they have changed its pronunciation. They took the vowel pronunciation. Is that clear?
No worries, clear, ma'am.
So diphthongs combination are maintained, diphthong combinations are maintained in spelling, but they have taken the vowel pronunciation. That's why we have different diphthong combination which are pronounced as vowels, as in leap, deal, people, P-E-O-P-L-E, people. So the combination is E and O, it's a diphthong combination, but it is pronounced as vowel, E sound. It's given a long vowel sound. Similarly, the Y sound, pronounced, the change of Y was another important feature. Middle English, this Y sound became E sound. So that's why the Middle English Y is still used to represent the E sound, whether long or short. Because in many words, we use Y, the sound Y is pronounced as E. That is because of the Old English influence. Because in Middle English, it was changed to the pronunciation of Y. Y is now, it's a consonant, it is pronounced as ear sound. But earlier, Y sound was, in Old English, it was rounded to E sound. Even now, even though the spelling is still Y, the pronunciation has changed to E sound. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Again, in Old English, there was a different sound, Z sound, that was pronounced as G. Later, it was modified as Y. Okay, the Old English, they had a different, that was pronounced as, even though the symbol is Z, it was pronounced as Y. The Z sound was pronounced as G. Then later, Y was introduced. That's why we have Y, the pronounced spelling Y, as Y, which is pronounced as year, but it follows a vowel pronunciation. Because in Middle English, the sound was spelled Y. It was a consonant. Okay? That's why we still have jail. The spelling of jail is, it was earlier, it was G-A-O-L. But the spelling has now changed to G. Even now we use G-O-A-L, but the spelling is J-A-I-L. But that time, because G was the Old English spelling. I think you can go read this, then you will understand it. Old English spelling, the changes of spelling. So we have... All these I have taken from your textbook. Similarly, chur was used to represent chur sound, which even now remains today as in choose. Then the difference between kur and kur. Kur and kur. In many words, we have kur pronounced, or all the words we have the pronunciation sir. A kur stands for both C letter and K letter, right? Either C or K can represent both the letters can represent the same sound, K. That also come because of this Old English influence. Because the words, when it comes before friend vowels, it was pronounced as, it used the spelling K. But when it came before back vowels, it was pronounced as sir. It used the letter C. That's why we have different variation for the same sound K, as in king and climb. Because when it came before friend vowels, the spelling was K, but when it came before back vowels, the spelling was sir. But both have the same pronunciation, K. But Latin influence, I discussed C, as the spelling, even though the spelling was C, the sound was sir. But nowadays we have cat, in the spelling of cat, we have C letter, but the pronunciation is kur. That is a result of the Old English use. Then later it was taken to modern English, Middle English, then that spelling is maintained as such. Even though the pronunciation kur, the pronunciation for both sir and kur are kur, but the rule was before front vowels. Ka, the spelling ka has to be used, and before back vowels, the spelling C has to be used. But we don't follow such rules now, but still the spelling is maintained as such. Okay. Again, they have accepted some alternative. We have some alternative spellings also. There, floor, flower, metal, metal. So these are some of the alternative spellings of words. Alternative spellings means only the spelling. Now we use it in a different sense. Finally, the omission of finally, that's a very important change that happened in the Middle English period, because after the Middle English period, you can see that Chaucer has used that E to rhyme the words. So fifi. So that E used to be pronounced earlier in Old English and Middle English also. But by the time of the modern English, or by 16th and 17th century, they have omitted the omission of the, they have omitted the final E from many words.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, that's why we don't pronounce that E any further. There, T-H-E-R-E, here, in all those words, that E spelling is maintained, but we pronounce it in, we don't pronounce it anymore. See, that's why in the 16th century, it became customary to use E and O sound only for sounds developed from Middle English. Only for the rhyming purpose, they used to pronounce it. Okay, clear? This is all about Old English spellings, then changes in vocabulary technologies. So can you read, when you come for the next class, can you come and read it? Vocabulary, changes in vocabulary, because we have already taken this, changes in vocabulary. Word formation as part of word formation. Borrowings means borrowing from the writers, borrowing from languages, different languages. Celtic borrowings are there, Latin borrowings are there. Then we have Scandinavian borrowings. Then languages from, borrowings from other languages like Greek, French. Then even Arab, India, Indian languages. So all those borrowings are given. Other borrowings means from Dutch, German, Portuguese. All these come under changes in vocabulary, borrowings. See, we have Celtic borrowings. That can be asked as a question for your exam. Word formation. This is a very important question which comes in this block also. Word formation. New creations. Echoism means onomatopoeic words. Sound symbolism. Sound meaningfulness and phonetic symbolism. Two types of sound symbol. Sound meaningfulness and phonetic symbolism.
Okay, ma'am.
Then compounding. Derivation. Back formation. All these things we have discussed. Shortening, conversion. See, when you study for your exam, I think you better go for block 2. Because here it is given in a abridged version. In the other textbook, it is given in a very detailed way. So here, you get a better analysis of the question. Shortening, conversion. So you can expect that question, word formation. It's a very important question. Blending, author's contribution. I think that part is missed in the fourth block, author's contribution. So you can write it down. So when you write the question for your exam, you can add that point, author's contribution. Contribution by Shakespeare, contribution by Milton, contribution by Ben Jonson, and so on. Keats, they have all contributed towards English language. So you can write, that's an additional point, author's contribution. So word formation is a very important question that comes in block 2 as well as in block 4. Okay.
Okay, ma'am.
So we have one more block to cover, that is changes in grammar. Do you want me to take it or shall I move on to syntax? Okay, I'll just brief the fourth chapter, fourth unit, changes in grammar, because some grammatical terms are given there that you may find difficult to understand. No problem. I'll take a 5 or 10 minutes for that, and thereafter I will move on to syntax. If possible,
okay, ma'am.
We have the class tomorrow, right?
Yes, ma'am. Class tomorrow. So if possible, you read unit 4, changes in grammar.
Okay.
Okay, then ma'am. We move on to syntax, that is block 5. Okay, thank you.
Ma'am, your number?
944.
Mm-hmm.
6364.
Mm-hmm.
351.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thanks a lot.
Ma'am, take care.
Bye, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Bye, ma'am.